Well, one of the figures who's been at the center of this entire privacy debate has been the former Attorney General of India, Mr. Mukul Rohatgi, who in fact had famously argued in the Supreme Court that one cannot have an absolute right over his or her body. Today we have Mr. Rohatgi joining us on NDTV. Mr. Rohatgi, thank you for joining us. In fact, you and I spoke just a couple of months ago as well when the Supreme Court began hearing this landmark case. At that time also, you reiterated your stand and you said that, you know, you felt that this entire issue in a sense was much ado about nothing, to quote your words, that privacy as a concept cannot be overarching, can't relate to everything in life. What did you think of today's Supreme Court judgment then?
Well, I still maintain that there is much ado about nothing for the simple reason that after I had quit, I did hear that the government stated that they agree that privacy is a fundamental right. And in fact, if I am not mistaken, the law minister has said so even today. So if the government also agrees that it's a fundamental right, and the petitioners want it to be declared as a fundamental right, then, well, then what's the difference? The difference is only in the boundaries or the parameters. That's number one. Number two, as far as I am concerned, I had made it clear to the court that whether it's not relevant, whether we agree or not as to what is the nature of the right, 8 judges of the Supreme Court 50 years ago had said that privacy is not a concept which is recognized in the Constitution. Now, today the court has overruled that 8 judges' judgment, and therefore today's judgment is the law, namely that this is a fundamental right. But I wish to make 1 or 2 points.
Mr. Rohatgi, let me just intervene on one point that you made about the government's position with the law minister today claiming that the government government's position was that it also felt it is a fundamental right. That's actually not true, because the government argued in court, and Mr. K.K. Venugopal, your successor, argued in court, and this is just in July, that it's a vague and an amorphous right that cannot be held as a fundamental right. This is what Mr. Venugopal said in court, and that the right to privacy argument is elitist.
Yeah, I agree.
And that is what the Supreme Court has actually struck down completely today.
Yes, you are right that it was argued that it is not a fundamental right, but a regular common law right. But what I am indicating is that if I am not mistaken, the law minister did say today somewhere that the government acknowledged it as a fundamental right.
But
you can check it out.
But not in court, Mr. Rohatgi. They didn't acknowledge that in court where the case was being argued.
Well, I agree. Well, as far as I am concerned, I told you that I had taken a position, what the 8 judges of the Supreme Court had said, that it is not a concept in our Constitution at all. That's a point that I had raised. The government, through the court, in the court, agreed to kind of bring it to a slightly different plane by admitting it to be some kind of a right. But the point which I wish to make is very, very important. The fundamental rights are engrafted in the Constitution. So they have to be physically put in a book called the Constitution. That right is only of Parliament to make the law, amend the law, repeal the law, change the Constitution. The court has no power to engraft more fundamental rights than they are already in the Constitution. And more importantly, the Constituent Assembly, under the able leadership of late Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and illustrious lawyers and knowledgeable people like Sir Aladi Krishna Swami, Dr. K.M. Munshi, this issue was debated by them in the Constituent Assembly. It was then called the secrecy of correspondence. That's how it was described. After a big debate, they decided to drop it. So when you decipher a document or the meaning of a document, you decipher what the document makers intended. That's why they're called framers of the Constitution.
But nations also evolve.
We
also evolve as nations, and I think the Supreme Court has made a reference to that today, that we cannot go by decided several decades ago, which is why there is a reference also very clearly.
I am aware. Now, the court has got over it by saying that was 60 years ago, the nation has evolved, and India at 70 cannot be shackled by what the thought was in 1946. Well, the short answer to this submission, with great respect, is that the aspirations of the people have to be reflected by the leaders of the people who represent a sovereign body called Parliament. If India has grown, if India's democracy has grown, you have gone to different levels, then it is for Parliament to take a call. Every day it amends laws, it amends the Constitution, it can amend the Constitution. It's been amended 100 times. It could have been amended. But there can be no amendment of the Constitution by a court, because you have two different spheres, the sphere of the judiciary and the sphere of Parliament. The two spheres do not overlap or coalesce, to be correct. And therefore, tomorrow, is it possible that every couple of years, new and new fundamental rights are added by a court, and then in the book, which is called the Constitution of India, we go on adding sub-clauses to Article 19, or go on adding beyond Article 30, 31, 32, 33, 34. I don't think that it is permissible.
Well, you seem to suggest that the court has overstepped that this is a case of judicial overreach. Is that what you are suggesting, Mr. Rohatgi?
Yes, in one way, yes.
That's pretty significant. You believe that the court this is judicial overreach. Let me ask you though, what is the impact this judgment could have on other aspects of the lives we live? There's they've said a lot, for instance, on sexual orientation. There's a sort of reference to Section 377, and they've linked that with today's order as well. There is one interpretation that if somebody wants to tomorrow challenge some of the beef laws in various states, they can now go and do that, saying that the state can't intrude into their homes. Do you see this judgment as having a bigger impact on all these areas, and perhaps more?
No, well, there is no doubt that it will have an impact. But let me tell you one thing. Whether privacy was a fundamental right or no fundamental right, even yesterday, nobody could barge into somebody's house, which is his castle. Because to barge into somebody's house, you need a warrant for search and seizure. That is the law even today. So that's not kind of going to change. But I want to pose a couple of questions. Or a couple of issues. See, every fundamental right is subject to reasonable restrictions which are provided in the Constitution itself. But those are provided in respect of constitutional rights which are already found in the book. So now if you have a new fundamental right which is not found in the book and you place it in the book, then what are the reasonable restrictions which will apply to this right? Because one thing is clear, no fundamental right is absolute. Nothing is absolute in this world. So how are we going to now find what the restrictions are? Because the Constitution provided the right and the restrictions clearly written out, like public interest, interests of the state, security of the nation, friendly relations with other countries, etc., etc. These are the restrictions on which laws can be made, and they will not be deemed to be breaching the Constitution. So what will be that here? So for that also you need a judicial evolution.
All right, well, Mr. Rohatgi, thank you for talking to us today.
Happen case by case. I mean, I don't know.
You clearly have your misgivings. You have your reservations. You haven't shifted from that position. Thank you for joining us today with your perspective on this landmark ruling today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks.